Hey guys, welcome to part two of the parking garage ceiling collapse video. Today we're going to introduce the particle system for the smaller cement debris. We're going to add puddles. We're going to build out the scene more with cement pieces and electrical wires. We're going to add ivy and we're going to tie it all together. We got a lot to do, so let's go. So I'm going to go ahead and go into splines and pick a line, and I'm going to draw a line around where I want the extra debris pieces to be. And this is going to define the bounds and the surface in which the extra debris pieces are going to be confined to. And one of the things that I found that I don't want the debris pieces to go too far away from the larger pieces. And also I'm keeping in mind that the Jeep on the left side of the screen on the clean plate, that Jeep and the tire that's attached to the back of it is going to be in the foreground. So I'm not going to extend the line too far beyond that, because then we're just rendering geometry that we're never going to see because it's behind the tire and behind the Jeep. I'm also going to watch out on the right-hand side to not intersect with that pillar that's there. And just a side note, if you want to edit the points on the line here, just go into vertex mode and then you can grab a point and drag it around so you can modify the bounds of the face or the line. I'm going to right-click on the line and convert it to an editable poly, and that's going to create a face and some geometry between all those points that I drew. So now I'm going to hit 6 and bring up the particle system, and I'm going to choose a standard flow, and I'm going to replace the position icon with position object and shape with shape instance. I'm also going to delete speed because the particles aren't moving, so we don't need speed. I'm going to max out the upper level there by just adding all nines, and then I'm going to limit the particle birth to frame 0. As a starting point, we'll change the amount to 500. And I'm going to pick the line as the emitter object, and now we can see that there are particles on the face of that surface. So I'm going to select our cement pieces, go into element mode, and then grab some of these broken pieces here. I'm going to hit detach, and that's going to take the selected pieces, detach them from the current group, and add them into their own group. So as I select them and move them, you can see that they're in their own group now. So I'll slide them off to the left as a copy. I'll go into element mode and bring this stray one off to the side, bring it a little bit closer to the rest of them. And then I'm going to change the pivot point to the center by going into hierarchy, pivot, effect pivot only, then center to object. Back in the particle system, I'm going to go to shape instance. I'm going to click on particle geometry object and select our group. We want to choose object elements, so it randomly picks an element from the group to scatter on the bounding surface. I'm going to go down to display, switch it to display geometry so we can actually see what it looks like. Now we see that our particles are there, but we need to do a little bit of work. They're rotated the wrong way, so we're going to go into rotation and click random horizontal, and that's going to align them with the surface horizontally. And then we're going to decrease the size by going to shape instance and reduce the scale and bring up the variation. I'm going to hit render, and that's looking pretty good. So I'm going to select our main cement objects. I'm going to go into the modify panel. I'm going to hit attach and then click on that group that I separated. Not the one off to the left, but the one that we made a copy of. So now they're all attached and they all move together just for a cleaner workflow. Just in case I need to move them, I don't have to select the multiple things. I'm going to select everything in the modifier stack, right click and collapse them all. And then you can see if we select the cement pieces and go into element mode, we still have access to each one of those individually. So we're not really losing anything. I'm going to add an unwrap UVW modifier. Click this button to select face mode. Select ID2, which is the broken faces. And you see if I select one, then it's really the surface faces. So we'll select 2 because we want the broken faces because we have to fix a couple of these things. I'm going to open the UV editor. On the bottom here, I'm going to select faces with material ID2. I'm going to move over to the material editor, make a multi-sub object, plug our surface material into slot 1, and then I'm going to import a broken cement face material for the faces tag material ID2, which again are the faces for the broken cement pieces. I'm going to import this damaged concrete texture, and you'll see it applied that to pretty much all the cement pieces, so we actually have to correct that. So I'm going to drag the broken face texture into slot 2. I'm going to rename it broken faces material ID2, just so we're clear. I'm going to select the surface material, name that concrete surface material ID1, and then I'm going to apply the multi-sub object to our mesh, and you can see that the texture changed according to material ID. So now we have to go back and fix material ID2. So again, select UV unwrap from the modifier stack, select ID2, open the UV editor, only show faces with material ID2, and click this button to flatten, and that'll lay out the faces with material ID2 onto the UV map. It'll take a second to process, but you'll end up with this. So then we can hold control, select the upper right corner, and click and drag so that we can scale this up so that the material actually gets smaller on the pieces, because right now it's too big. So that's looking pretty good. I'm going to close that down. And I'm going to apply a V-Ray UVW randomizer and plug this into the mapping slot for all of the nodes here. So this will act as a master controller for the mapping. So if we change it in here, it's going to change in all of the materials so that all the materials, the diffuse, bump, roughness, and displacement will all match and have the correct mapping. So I'm just going to change the tiling to 3 and 3, and that's looking good. I think that that's going to work for our broken faces material. It looks to be the right size there, so we'll get some good detail once we add displacement. So basically here I'm going in and adjusting the color. I made a copy of our base material for the surface material and just made it black and white by adding a color correction node and then decreasing the saturation. I've gone ahead and made a multi-sub texture node. Again, this is covered in the previous two videos, but we'll just go through it really quick. So I'll take the color corrected displacement for the concrete surface and I'll plug that into texture 1. And then I'll take the displacement for the broken faces material, which is material ID 2, and plug that into the second slot. Our V-Ray displacement modifier was already applied, but if it's not applied to your mesh, go ahead and apply that. The amount is set at 8, so I'm going to choose -4 for the shift, because again, as we covered in the last video, we want to take the amount, divide it in half, and then put a negative in front of it. Then I'll apply the multi-sub texture into the texture map of the V-Ray displacement modifier. And now you can see here that we have the textures in the right spot. The broken faces have their own texture and their own displacement, and the surface texture has its own displacement. So the broken faces are looking too bright and too saturated, so I have to apply a color correction to the diffuse material of the broken faces, and I'll just desaturate it. And when I render that out, you can see they're not overly saturated, but they're still too bright, so I'm going to lower the brightness a little bit and render again, and that's looking pretty good. We also want to apply the multi-sub-object material to the group of geometry that we use for our particle system. And again, we're going to have to adjust the UVs for material ID 2. So we'll go in and scale that up, and that's looking good. So we're going to create the puddles now, and this is going to get a little bit tricky because we have the shadow catcher and we also need to put a ground plane down in order to use the texture of the ground. So we have to camera map it and project it and all that, and then plus we have to add reflections to it so it looks like there's water there. Before we go forward, I'm just going to clarify that I'm only going to put puddles in a specific area, which is right here. So it looks like there's water in front of these stones and underneath them, and maybe a source of nourishment or life for the ivy that's growing there. And you kind of want to think about that because you want to make sure that there's a little bit of realism so that when people look at this, they think that this could possibly happen. So we're not going to use the entire ground floor. We're going to create it, but we're going to mask it in After Effects. And then we're going to just use that as sort of like a patch on the ground in After Effects. So just keep that in mind as we move forward here. So I'm going to duplicate our shadow catcher here, and we're going to have to undo the properties for the shadow catcher so that we're not just making another shadow catcher. We're actually going to be using the duplicate as a texture or a new floor. So we'll make sure we make a copy, not an instance of it, and we'll rename it Puddles Surface. So I'm going to right-click and go into the V-Ray properties, and I'm going to uncheck Matte Object and Matte for Reflection. I'm going to change the alpha contribution from -1 to 1, and that'll undo the Shadow Catcher properties, and I'll close out of this. With the Puddles Surface geometry selected, I'm going to go into the Modifier stack and select a Camera Map modifier and apply that. Make sure you choose the regular Camera Map modifier and not the World Space modifier that's usually up at the top. I'm going to click Pick Camera, and I'm going to select our V-Ray camera that we created earlier, and that should set up the camera projection. So we have to tell the camera what to project, so I'm going to create a new V-Ray material, and I'm going to select the clean plate as the texture, and then I'm going to apply that to the puddle's surface. So make sure you shut off the shadow catcher before you check this render. So I'm going to render, and you'll see that something happened, but it looks messed up. I'm going to solo the puddles layer. The main reason why it looks messed up is because we don't have enough geometry. So I'm going to add more geometry. Instead of 4x4, I'm going to make it 50x50. And you can see that that fixed it. If I switch it back to 4x4, take a look at that. The projection is all messed up. Everything's curved and broken. But if you switch it to 50x50 and give it enough geometry, then that'll work. Now, I'm going to turn everything back on and I'm going to hit render, and you'll see that that actually turns on the shadow catcher as well. The floor looks kind of messed up, so that's why I said disable the shadow catcher before you check this render. And that's because the shadow catcher and the puddles layer are in the exact same position. So you can actually change the position of the puddles layer by changing the Z position to 0.1 centimeters, and that's going to raise it up slightly. A little bit of a hack, but that'll work. And it's such a small amount that you're lifting it off the Z axis that it's probably not going to matter. Now in the end, I'm going to render this out as a separate layer, and then I'm going to cut it in After Effects and mask it out so that I'll have puddles just in the places that I want. So keep in mind, you'll have to do a separate pass for the puddles floor layer. So in order to make puddles, we actually need a V-Ray blend material. And that's because we need the original texture, just reflective, and then we want to create patches on the surface. So we'll take our original material, plug it into coat 1, and then we'll duplicate it, but we'll change the reflection and we'll turn it all the way up to white. And so you can see what that looks like here. So I'm just going to add a box so we could just double check this, and I'm also going to add a light on top of it. So we need a black and white fractal noise texture for the mask. So we'll just make a noise texture and switch it to fractal. And I'm going to set the levels to 10 because that gives us nicer edges. It kind of breaks it up and gives us more detail on the edges. And then I'll take that and I'll plug it into blend 2. And that's going to be the mask for the reflection layer. And then underneath that, what's plugged into coat 1 is just the floor texture, but no reflection. And so you could see that here. So I'm going to adjust the position of the puddles here. But first I'm going to make an adjustment to the size. I'm going to make the size around 120. And then I'm going to play with the offset so I can position the puddles in the right spot, which would be underneath and right in front of a lot of the crumbled pieces, sort of as if acting as a source of water for the ivy that we're about to add. So let's add some ivy. I'm going to click here and add a new Tyflow flow, and we'll go into the editor and we'll right click and add a preset flow for the ivy. It comes in with the sphere and the ivy is wrapping around it. So we're going to delete that. We're going to go into the grow operator and remove the sphere that we deleted. And then we're going to pick the geometry that we want the ivy to latch onto. In this case, it's going to be the concrete slab. Under the ivy roll down, we're going to change the speed to 1 and the max age to 450. That's a pretty good start. Now we can play with these settings. And basically the speed is how fast the ivy grows. But what I've noticed is that the speed affects how much the ivy vines, not the leaves, grow on the object. And then the age affects both the vines and the leaves. And so you have to kind of work between both of those in order to get the desired effect that you want. So we'll play around with the settings until we get something that we like. And one of the things that I want to keep an eye out for is the gap between the two large pieces of cement. Since we shoved rebar in there, we want to see the rebar, but it looks like the ivy is kind of bunching up there as it would in real life. So we may have to go in and adjust the gap between those two pieces and also adjust the point at which the ivy latches on to the bottom concrete slab. At this point, I only have one position icon surface. So what I actually ended up doing was increasing the size of the position icon object. And I noticed that I only had one point at which the ivy was coming off of the position object icon. I then increased it to 5. And then I think I ended up in the end with 10 points. And that just scattered the points throughout the position icon object, so that it had more points, and so the ivy wasn't as thick. But I still ran into an issue where the ivy bunched up too much between the gaps on the larger concrete slabs. So what I ended up doing was duplicating the position icon object, so I had 2 of them, and then I moved that up to the bottom edge of the upper slab. So it's a little bit of a cheat, but that's where it was bunching up, so I figured that's a good contact point for the second position object. And by doing this, I would be able to decrease the age of the ivy so that it wouldn't bunch up as thick, and so I would be able to keep the age lower, but still have a good scattering of the ivy going all the way up the concrete slab. And then finally, I added another position icon object to some of the pieces on the floor. I don't know if it's really necessary, but I think it's a nice touch because it's near the bottom slab, and that's where a point of contact would be for the ivy. So maybe some of the ivy grabbed onto some of those pieces. So to texture this, I'm just going to create a new material for the ivy, and I'll give it a yellowish green color. And technically, you could just apply this to the Tyflow, but in order to get a little bit more accurate colors, I'm actually going to color the vines a separate color. I'm going to create a multi-sub object material, and I'm going to go into the properties of the ivy here. And you can see here that the stems and the vines and the leaves each have their own material ID. So in the multi-sub object, plug in the texture into the corresponding IDs to match the numbers here in the properties roll down. So for the stems, I'm going to make a brown wood kind of color. And that's going to be good enough. You can get a little bit more complicated with the textures, but we'll keep it simple for this. And I find that it looks pretty decent from a distance. So let's go ahead and fix our HDRI. And what I'm noticing here mainly is that we're barely getting any reflections. I'm going to check finite dome. That's going to affect our position, the radius, the scale of the HDRI, as well as rotation. As I move this around, you can see that the reflections are kind of coming into place. So what I actually want to do is open up the environment map by pressing 8 on the keyboard and then uncheck use map and then uncheck invisible from the dome light settings so that I can see what the dome is actually looking like. And then I can line it up better to our shot. So once I have that in place, I'm finally going to adjust the position of the reflections or the puddles by just playing with the offset controls so I get the puddles in the position that I want them. To make it look like the floor above collapsed in, causing the ceiling to collapse, I'm going to detach this upper part of the cement slab. I'm going to duplicate it, and I'm going to place it up by the ceiling, and I'm going to duplicate it 2 more times and arrange those pieces to almost imply a hole in the ceiling as if it collapsed inward. Then I'm going to take some of the rebar pieces that we made, and I'm just going to shove them into these meshes, making sure to adjust the ends and make any necessary loop cuts if I need to, in order to create the appearance that they bent when the destruction happened. As far as the cables go, I have a plugin called Random Cable Generator. It's a pretty cheap script. It's on CG Trader. I think it's something like 20 bucks at the time of this recording. Basically, what you want to do is select a face and then on the first box and hit first target, and then select the face on the second box and hit last target. And then you want to set the Z direction to a negative number and then just click on Create Cable. Now, I don't think that's drooping down far enough. What I'm going to do is instead of negative 60, I'll do negative 120. And that's actually looking better. So I can just delete all these cables and start over. With negative 20, I can just hit Create Cable a bunch of different times, and that's looking pretty good. So I can just delete our two boxes here and then delete the caps that come with it. It's probably better to do that over on the layer editor, so you can just select all the caps and then just delete them. One thing to notice is that this may look like a physics simulation, but it's really not. It's just still geometry, but we don't need a physics sim for this. But then keep in mind that if you want to adjust the way the cables look, you'll have to generate brand new cables instead of moving the endpoints as you would in a physics sim. But these are looking the way I want, so I'm not going to have to make any adjustments. So once I've deleted the caps, I can just select all of the wires and move them into position. So in this case, I'm going to put them right here and then lift them up so that they look like they're hanging from the ceiling. So that looks good. I'll position them right there. So I'm just going to create a dummy object and I'll place that in a position where it's easily accessible. In this case, it's a little bit above the wires, but I want to use this as my master controller so I don't have to select all the wires. I can just select one basically dummy object, and then I'll just link all the cables to the dummy object. And now I can just use the dummy to control the position of all the cables. So now I'm just going to grab all the cables, shift and drag to duplicate them. And then I'll do the same thing with the dummy object. I'll shift and drag that, put that above the second set of cables. And then I'll link those cables to that new dummy object so that I can control those separately as a group. Then I'll just play with the position of those until I think they look good. And now I've selected all the wires and I'm just going to create a cable material. So I'm going to drop another V-Ray material down in the material editor. I'm going to change the name to cable material. I'm going to make the color black, but most cables have a little bit of a glossiness or a reflection to it for the casing. So I'm just going to add a tiny bit of reflection to it so it has that gloss. And now when I render it out, you can see it has a little bit of that gloss. And also from the lights that we added on the right side of the frame, you can see that there's a little bit of definition in the cables where they're catching the light on their right side. So it's a little bit brighter on their right side. And that just helps them to look more realistic. I'm going to adjust the mesh a little bit and I'm just going to create a larger gap between these two larger cement pieces. And because I'm doing that, I'm going to have to adjust the rebar pieces. So I'm just going to move them down and just make sure that they're not sticking out of the mesh where we don't want them to. And that's looking good. So I'm going to open up Tyflow and I'm going to re-enable the ivy. And that's actually looking really good because now we have a larger gap between the pieces and it's a lot more noticeable. The ivy doesn't cover it up. But one thing that is happening is that part of the ivy that's on the surface is actually disappearing when we render. But in the viewport, it looks fine. And that's because of the displacement that we have applied on the mesh through the V-Ray displace modifier. So we're going to have to actually go in and make some adjustments to that so that the ivy doesn't disappear because the mesh is being displaced. So right now, the shift is set to -6, which is exactly half of the amount of the displacement. And like I said, that's a good starting place, but sometimes we have to fine tune it from there. So I'm actually going to do -6.5 just to kind of pull the mesh back a little bit more. And then we notice here that a lot of that ivy, the stems and things are actually coming back in. So that's actually looking pretty good, but I'm going to pull it back just a little bit more. I'll check keep continuity, and that actually helps a little bit more. So now I'm actually going to duplicate the side light so we have another one, and that's looking pretty good. But what I'm noticing is that in front, the ivy has very dark shadows and the surface overall is just very dark. So I'm just going to add a very soft light up front. So I'll make it a kind of a large rectangle, but make the intensity pretty low. And that just gives us a little bit more of the lighting up front so we don't get such deep shadows and everything doesn't look darker than the surroundings. So as a final touch, I'm going to import some of these Quixel assets. These are grass assets. And I think that this is going to be a nice touch because we can throw them on the cracked cement ground as if through the cracks, the grass sprouted up and life found a way because, you know, it always does. And here I'm just making some final adjustments to the key elements. I had to scale them up because I thought they were too small, so make sure you select all the key elements and scale them up with the slab. And one final thing I noticed about the rebar is that now that we've scaled everything up and moved it around, the rebar is actually sticking out of the cement slabs, so I have to just go in and fix that. And once I do that, render it out, and it looks good. Alright guys, so if you like this video, please like and subscribe so I can continue bringing you guys more of these videos. Stay tuned for part 3, where we're going to talk about render passes, how to set that up, what to render out, which ones we need. Then we're going to take everything and bring it into After Effects and make everything look good. So once again, my name is Paul Delvecchio, and I'll catch you next time.